So what are the new trends, or what is one sectoral trend?
I think financials are clearly leading it. There is this.
So today we have amongst us Mr. Atul Suri, who is the Chief Investments Officer with Marathon Trends PMS. PMS, you know, your PMS has covered more than 2 years of performance.
That's right. That's right.
You know, out of the last 2 years, I think 18 months has been a very tough time.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I would like to understand from you what has been your journey. How is, you know, so first of all, you know, just for out of curiosity, let me know, you know, what is the name Marathon Trend? What does it signify?
Yeah, I think it's very symbolic and it really sort of brings out what we do. I have been a marathon runner, so I do have a passion for running. So when you run a marathon, I believe that what you require is belief, firstly. And, you know, when you are running such a long distance, someone tells you that, oh, you know, you will run so many kilometers, immediately say it's not possible. So the first and foremost, you have to believe. And then it's the same thing that goes in investments, especially when you're doing long-term trend investments that we are doing. You need belief in your methodology, in stocks that you hold. Second is discipline. Discipline, just as when you run a marathon, it's just not just the thought that I can run so many kilometers. You've got to wake up every morning, spend hours, train, diet. You require immense amount of discipline. It requires months and maybe years of training till you can run a marathon. Even investing has the same style, which is about having discipline. Not every stock you buy is a multi-bagger or winner, though you wish it is. But the fact is, you have to be able to accept your mistakes and ride your winners. And that is what creates a great portfolio. And the third quality, which I think which is common in running a marathon and investing, is perseverance. Just as every kilometer you run is not the same. Sometimes you have aches, pains, cramps, shin splints. You go through immense amount of pain. However, you have to persevere. If you do not persevere, you will give up the marathon. So also in investments, you cannot have bull markets every year. You'll have bull markets, bear markets, outperformance, underperformance. You'll go through a lot in your career. But it is your perseverance that will lead you through. So the common qualities of mind which I see in running a marathon and in investments, which is belief, discipline and perseverance. So that is why I feel that our style in investing is the same. And trends is something that ultimately every investor makes money only through trends. Whether you are a Warren Buffett or even if you're an intraday trader, what you're looking for is you're looking to buy a stock at a certain price and hope that it will trend in a direction and you'll be able to exit at some point in time. So we are all looking for trends, whether you're looking for price trends, whether you're looking for earning trends. Ultimately, it is our job. We make money on trends. So what we are doing in our PMS is nothing but running marathon trends. And that's how the name Marathon Trends PMS comes.
Sure. So what are the financial factors, you know, that you would look for as cues before picking a stock?
So we have a very unique style of investing, which is very, very unique and probably the only of its kind in India. We actually look for trending earnings and trending prices.
Okay.
So we actually combine fundamentals and technicals. What we really look for is, as I said, we look for companies with consistent compounding growth. And we feel that it is very important that when you have trending earnings, even Mr. Market should recognize it. Very often you have stocks that move in prices, but the earnings are not trending. That has the makings of a bubble. And it may be very cute for some point in time, but when it ends very bad. And the last year has shown us that. Similarly, this is something which a lot of people do not agree, but I strongly have experienced that in my 26 years in the markets, is that sometimes as an analyst, we believe that this is a stock with great earnings, trending earnings. However, you find that Mr. Market is not recognizing. You're not having trending prices. And it is very important for that stage to go and revisit my thesis. Because I believe that Mr. Market is a very, very smart adversary and one must respect it. So I actually study earnings and I study prices. And I combine these two. It's only when both are pointing north do I get into investment. So our style is what you call trend investing. We look for trending earnings and we look for trending prices for the long term.
So what can be expected of your product from investors' perspective? So in terms of number of stocks, in terms of allocation, in terms of volatility in terms of, you know, churning in the portfolio?
So we run a max 20 stock portfolio, let's say max. So it's fairly concentrated in that sense of the term. We do not even have very differentiated, we have pretty equal weightage in across the portfolio. The churn historically has been about 20 to 30%, and this really has been the style. However, where we differentiate or what we really value, which is very intrinsic to, apart from picking stocks, is to manage what we call money management. And here we strongly believe in the principle of cutting your losses and letting your profits run. So we are very, very impatient with losers, and we have no qualms or egos about exiting losers, because we find that the Waterloo of most investors is, however good a stock picker they are going to encounter some difficult stocks. And if you maintain your ego and keep backing them, sooner or later they are going to humble you. So we are absolutely clear about not sticking with losers for very long. When companies' growth rates come down, when prices start detrending, we do not have any qualms about accepting a mistake, exiting, because not only do you minimize further losses, you also miss a very big opportunity loss. So we believe in cutting your losses as rule number one, non-negotiable, written in stone. And the second thing is about being able to ride your winners. We have seen that when trends emerge, when stocks start moving, they actually surprise on the upside. And we don't like to fiddle around with that. We really don't know what is the target price for any stock. When trends happen, who knew what were the trends in 2000, 2008? Prices went to some crazy heights. And I think it's very important to be able to ride that. So keeping drawdowns low, we really, really value that, which happens by virtue of our first principle, as I said, of cutting your losses. And whenever you get a trend, you should be able to ride it and don't try to second guess it or trying to find the top. So cutting your losses, riding your winners is intrinsic to our philosophy, to money management. And I think these styles of managing money is what really sets them apart from most of the products in the market.
Would you like to cover a couple of stocks and, you know, where you can maybe explain with the example that why you entered and maybe, you know.
Sure, one thing we can talk about is that, you know, post the 2008-09 crash in financial markets, well, the first sector that actually emerged with very good strong earnings and even price movements was actually pharma. And at those stages, you know, we found ourselves getting into a lot of pharma stocks. Sun Pharma, Lupin, Ajanta, Alembic, Natco. So we were all overweight pharma. And by virtue of price movements, they really did very well. Till suddenly, I think in 2016 or so, you started having some issues and some poor acquisitions, mainly by Sun Pharma. But more important, this whole US FDA thing. And we are, after riding a beautiful trend from 2009-10 till, you know, when you ride a trend for 4-5 years, you start rationalizing and believe that actually pharma is a stock, is a sector for life, because it is recession proof. Till human beings are alive, they'll consume medicines.
Right.
So we thought we were in a winner for life and we were on autopilot. Just as the last 3-4 years were autopilot in pharma and every year was a better year, we thought this would go on for life. And suddenly you had this new animal of US FDA warnings. And in 3 months, the whole sector got derated. And stock after stock, the trend started breaking, the numbers started moving for a toss. And it was a very painful experience to exit. You know, when you do fall in love with stocks. But at that stage, to have the emotional detachment to be able to sell was very crucial. And we found that those exits, which as I said, were very painful because you were riding them for very long. And you started believing that, oh, these are trends for life, were getting replaced by some financial stocks. And those got replaced by Bajaj Finances and FinServs and many others and all. So really, this is the big thing. And if you look at the prices we sold pharma stocks, from there, most have even halved as of today. And more importantly is what you got into. As I said, the opportunity gains have more than doubled. So that is really the style of trend analysis. At all points in time, we are there to look at these mega trends that are there. Sectors that have secular things which are multi-years in nature, get into them in a concentrated way. And most importantly, the trickiest part, the most difficult part, is to be able to exit when the trend changes. Because when you exit that, the market will throw up another trend.
And it's our job to do that.
So what are the new trends? What is one sectoral trend?
I think financials are clearly leading it. This trend has been going on for 2-3 years. And even in the most difficult of times, you notice that last year was a very difficult year for the market. But whenever the market revives, the stocks that make new highs have essentially been in financials. Consumption till a few months of weeks ago was also in that sphere. It is going through a bit of a wobble at the moment, but I really think still it doesn't tell me that the long-term trend is over. I still think that they are going through a correction, and I feel that they will revive. So I think these are the two things that are really panning out, or that's what's getting reflected in that portfolio.
Right. In your example, you had mentioned 2008-2009, but your PMS is 2 years old.
So I was managing money at that stage for a prop per book. So those are experiences I'm sharing from my experience with the prop.
Right. So basically, this trend-oriented investment philosophy is something which you have been doing for.
I've been doing it for years. I've been in the market for 26 years, and I started my career actually with one of India's first brokers to do fundamental research, a broker called Parag Parikh.
Okay.
So I started my career in 1990.
Okay.
That was the time of the Harshad Mehta bull market.
Right.
And I spent a lot of time in that area. I was also in the institutional side of broking, handling FI desk again, covering more of the fundamental side. And later on, post 2003 or so, I got into the area of studying price movements, studying cycles. And today what I am is a combination of both these experiences, thought processes. And I personally think that the ability to combine them is a very, very delicate, but a very, very powerful balance to have. Most people belong to bucket A or bucket B. There are very few people who are able to combine both of them. And hopefully we would be able to demonstrate that in the years to come.
So last thing that I would want to understand from you, given your experience, what is it, what are the factors, three top factors that any equity investor should keep in mind while selecting the equity product?
I think that one thing that most investors I get into, that they have a very recent bias. Like whatever fund is doing well in the last 3 months, that's all they want to get into. And I find that is very, very dangerous. You must look at something with, there's a first concept of rolling returns. One should look at that, especially when you're a more mature or more sophisticated investor, one should look at rolling returns. But most people find it a little difficult concept. So first, I would say look at rolling returns, go and study it. It's beyond the scope of this for me to explain it, but look at rolling returns. Second is look at max drawdowns. Max drawdown means that what is the worst that happened to your portfolio? You see, in a bull market, you'll find that very often the more rash you are, the higher your returns you are, because that's the nature of the market. But the true test of any portfolio manager is that when the chips are down, what is the drawdown that you had? Because this is the point when two things happen. One is my ability as a portfolio manager to implement and follow my method gets tested. When you have very, very deep drawdowns, we all get emotionally affected by it. And number two is the confidence the client has in you when you have very severe drawdown also gets tested. So in this journey, which is about running marathons, having such sort of slack or having such sort of deep drawdowns will make sure that you are never able to finish the journey or never able to finish the distance. And this whole power of compounding, and we hear these 5-year, 10-year, 20-year stories, you will find that all these stories are only possible if you have low drawdowns. If you have very large drawdowns, you will find that you do not do the journey, because always at the bottom, you will be frustrated, angry at somebody else, at some fund manager, at equity markets, at some government or whatever, and exit the market, and you will find that you miss the whole cycle. So keeping drawdowns low in your selection of a fund, it's not just about returns, it's also about drawdowns. Look at max drawdowns, understand the concept of max drawdown, and what I said earlier was rolling returns. And the third thing that I will share with you is another line which I recently heard, which says that alpha is cyclical. No fund manager, no strategy, no scheme can be the best performer always. So you must understand that if something is outperforming today, there is a very good chance it will underperform tomorrow. However, it is for you to look beyond cycles and bet on a strategy or a scheme. That is why I mentioned rolling returns earlier, which is able to navigate well through cycles. You do not have to be the best performer always, because very often, very outlier performances tend to underperform later, and the journey gets very volatile, and the journey does not remain long term. Just make sure that you're into something that's good, something that's able to ride cycles, yes, outperform well in up market, but more important is to keep drawdowns low, because it's only that fund or that fund manager which will be able to revive and be able to make new highs. So avoid extremely volatile strategies, extremely volatile returns. Don't go for outliers, because very often the volatility and the journey becomes very short.
Thank you so much. It has been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.